Good evening, Alaska. It's Dr. Ann Zink, and I just wanted to provide a brief update on where we're at with COVID around the state. So looking at the next slide, I'm going to just talk a little bit about the data, our testing and our percent positivity, what's happening with viral transmission, as well as the different actions that Alaskans can do to really slow the spread of this disease. So moving on to the next slide, this is our epi curve, which many of you are very familiar with at this point. And you can see our new cases are listed in the yellow. The most newest cases are those on the gray bar off to the side. Those ones were still under investigation. And based on that, we kind of calculate what our projections look like. So based on this, it looks like we may double the number of cases that we have in the next 22 days. Our growth rate is approximately 3% right now. But remember that this graph, just like this pandemic in the past, is really determined by what Alaskans choose to do. We've pushed this graph down before and really pushed these numbers down before, and really asking Alaskans to do that again. Unfortunately, our numbers right now are not being driven by any one single outbreak. We're seeing cases in many communities, seeing them spread between family and friends, and seeing them both in small as well as large group gatherings. And that's the reason that we are concerned this will continue to spread. So let's take a little bit closer look across the state and what we're seeing. Moving on to the next slide, this is our statewide alert, and this is based on the number of new cases that we've had over the last 14 days, and that's per day per 100,000 people. So currently, unfortunately, we are in this red zone, and that is greater than 10 cases per 100,000 per day. Currently, statewide, we're at 16.3 cases per 100,000. Moving on to the next slide, these next set of slides will be a 7-day rolling average. It just gives you a better sense of how things are moving in a short time frame. And again, you can see all of this on our data dashboard. This is the Anchorage area. It continues to be in the red zone as well, with 25.75 cases per 100,000 per day currently. Moving on to the next slide, you can see the Fairbanks North Star Borough continues to be increasing in its cases as well. We have 37.54 cases per 100,000. And again, kind of seeing that upward trajectory and projection for the Fairbanks region. Moving to the next slide, we continue to see quite a few cases in the Northwest region at 33.33 cases per 100,000. And then moving on to the next slide, this is another region that we're starting to see pick up as well, quite a bit lower than the other three, but the MATSU has picked up into that upper orange region at 7.92 cases per 100,000 and is in that intermediary zone. Again, you can check your region on our website to see where you're at in your region. Moving on to the next slide, we broke down the cases looking by age group. And so here you can see week over week in the different age groups. And so that green line on there is the 20 to 39 year old age group. The dark blue is the 0 to 19. And the lighter blue is the 40 to 59 age group. So really we continue to see that 20 to 29 age group really has been picking up, but all of the different age groups have been picking up over the last couple of weeks. So again, a little breakdown by age for you. Moving on to the next slide, the team's been putting a lot of time and effort to try to get caught up on some of the previous race and ethnicity data. So it's been great to see the under investigation go down. But here's the breakdown of COVID cases by race and ethnicity across the state. Moving on to the next slide, I really like to compare to see where we're at compared to other states and see how other states are doing. It helps us get a sense of what we might expect via travel and kind of helps us to know what resources may or not be available and just get a better sense of where Alaska's at. And so this, you can look at different states by population, and this is over a 7-day period. So blue is the Alaska line, continue to check up there. You can see that you had this big surge initially for New York, particularly with that big surge on that first wave. That second big wave was when we were seeing a lot of cases in Texas and Arizona. And then you can see this third wave that's kind of hitting has really been in Midwest. So North Dakota and South Dakota are that red and green line at the top, followed by Wisconsin and Montana and Utah. Again, we are quite a bit below those, which is great to see, but unfortunately kind of trending up and greater than, we have more cases per 100,000 than more than 50% of the states at this time. Moving on to the next slide, this is our hospitalizations by race and ethnicity, as well as age. And so you can see our grouping on the left-hand side that looks at the total hospitalization by different race, and then again by age. So we've had 5 kids between the ages of 0 and 19 who have required hospitalizations, but the majority of our hospitalizations are in that 60 to 79 age group on there. Total of 300 hospitalizations of Alaskans since the start of this pandemic. I just wanted to share a little bit more data about what we've seen specifically in Alaska regarding deaths and hospitalizations. I have had a lot of fantastic questions over this in the last 24 hours. So we looked back at our data from the beginning of this pandemic to now, and we looked at if you were diagnosed with COVID, what was the chance that you were hospitalized, and what was the chance that you passed away? Again, we looked at this for the statewide, and there has been quite a bit of national data coming out on this. And so you can see really at the beginning of the pandemic, people were much more likely to be hospitalized if they were diagnosed with COVID, as well as higher likelihood to unfortunately pass away. As this pandemic has gone on, that ratio has continued to drop over time. Probably a series of causes by this. We don't think that the virus has changed significantly, but we do think that we're identifying more cases early in younger people. And so that helps us to break those chains of transmission before they get to people who are older or more vulnerable. It also helps us to keep it at a long-term care facilities and other places where we expect higher hospitalization and higher death rates. And then we are getting better at treatment. So we are learning different ways to treat people with COVID. There are new medications and treatment options out and continue to see a lot of progress. Early on in the pandemic, you know, we said we really want to kind of flatten that curve, keep underneath that hospitalization capacity. And the longer we kind of push out your exposure to that case, the more likely you are to do well. And so you can kind of start to see that in our state data. Moving on to the next slide, this is the national data that also looks at that. So you can see in general, when we get a surge of cases, we do get more hospitalizations. And you can see kind of that first surge when we saw on the East Coast and that second surge that we saw in the South, we saw a following set of hospitalizations, usually about 2 weeks after the cases surged. We saw those hospitalizations come up. But in general, those peaks aren't nearly as high as the cases before. And we're seeing that kind of generally trend down over time. And you can see that based on age group. Unfortunately, that 65-year-old age group continues to be the group that is hit hardest in requiring hospitalization. And you can see that other age groups, particularly that 0 to 4, stays pretty flat on that region. Moving on to the next slide, this is the total deaths per month. And so you can see this is again in Alaska that they really peaked in August. Again, that's the total deaths. So our cases really started to pick up in July. And then we saw that reflected in the number of cases that required hospitalization as well as deaths in August. And then fortunately in September, really started to see that taper off, which was great to see. October's still early on and hoping to really get people to get tested early, to really minimize your transmission, washing your hands, wearing your mask to really minimize that transmission so we can push these cases down so we don't see more hospitalizations and we don't see more deaths in the state of Alaska. Moving on to the next slide, this is the percent positivity rate, and this just gives us a sense if we're doing enough testing. There's a bunch of different metrics that we use to say, is it enough testing or isn't it? We've done almost 500,000 tests in the state so far, and our percent positivity has been creeping up over the last 7 days. So we're at 4.28%. We still are one of the most tested states in the nation, but seeing that creep up suggests that we need to think about the regions where there's outbreaks and what can we do to get more testing there and encourage people to get tested at the beginning of any new symptoms. So let's break it down a little bit further and look in different regions. So if you look at the next slide, these are a few different regions. Again, on our website, you can go and take a look at the different regions in your area. And you can see that the Fairbanks area has been steadily climbing. That's that purple line there, and they are at 11.78%. The Anchorage area has also been creeping up at 5.13%. Matsu starting to barely creep up at 3.86%. The Northwest Arctic Borough, you can see really kind of peaked high, nearly just above 10%, and now has been coming down, down to 4.8%. So that's what we want to see as we identify those cases early and bring those numbers down. And that really involves a lot of testing quickly and early so we can identify cases, isolate people who have been infected with COVID, contact trace, help people find their contacts, and then ask those contacts to stay in quarantine to 14 days so that they can really be the people who help to stop that transmission from others. Moving on to the next slide, this is a slide looking at the percent positivity from the airport. So you can see over time, when people come into the airport, we have varying levels of the percent positivity. And these seem to correspond with when we see spikes in the lower 48. So when we saw that kind of southern spike, we saw a spike in our percent positivity, and then it came down nicely. And we're starting to see another spike in our percent positivity from the airport testing. Again, less than the statewide as a whole, just over 1%, but you can see that number climbing there. Moving on to the next slide, this is our state compared to other states, and this looks at testing per capita. So again, we've been kind of in that top one, two, three category for some time. North Dakota has a lot of cases right now, and they are doing a lot of testing, and they're that red line at the top. Rhode Island from the beginning has been doing tremendous amount of testing. They're there, and then we're that blue line below that. So it's great to see the testing that's happening in Alaska and really appreciate the providers and patients and everyone who's getting that testing so we can identify those cases early. It's kind of like having your brights on the highway. The faster we go, the more lights we need to be able to identify it. And so we really want to keep a light on this pandemic so that we can identify it and give people the tools and resources to end it and keep people moving forward. So how do we do that? Moving on to the next slide, how do we really slow the transmission? We hear a lot of stories from our contact tracers about friends and family. And so I think people have done an amazing job of kind of moving those bubbles small. But what we're seeing is a lot of bubbles kind of connected. And so here you can see these bubbles mixing together. And so one person on that bottom right might get COVID and maybe they don't want to get tested, or they have difficulty getting tested. Or they're spreading the disease before they have symptoms and they don't know to get tested and maybe they were exposed. And then they hang out with a family, maybe at work, and they've got their small bubble, but then they went and visited a friend that was a small bubble, and you can see how it spreads really quickly until maybe one of those people is working in a long-term care facility or go visits an elder, and then they're the ones who get it sick. So it's just a highly contagious disease, and you can see that it kind of one bubble can lead to another. So you wanna really think about who else your bubbles are also seeing. So we really wanna keep those gatherings small, really minimizing those indoor gatherings, those closed spaces, crowded places, and close contacts really spread the disease. And we really wanna make sure we're not like riding in carpool with other people, not changing in locker rooms with other people. Really wanna have that space and distance from other people as much as possible to minimize the transmission. Moving on to the next slide, again, just a reminder of the symptoms. It's crazy to me how hard this disease is to diagnose clinically and why a test can really just give you the tool to know if you're COVID positive. Most of the time it's not. So even at a 4% positive, that means that most of the time, you know, 96% of the time, it's not gonna be COVID. But that 4% is, it really makes a big difference at slowing the transmission overall. So take home steps on the last slide, wearing a mask. It's a big thing that you can do to minimize your ability to spread it to others, even if you're asymptomatic. But there is good data now to show that you're less likely to get really sick, more likely to be asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic if you're wearing a mask as well. Limiting your errands and your outings, really trying to pull those bubbles back in small, maintaining that distance if you're inside at all, so really keeping that 6 feet even with a mask, making sure you answer the call. So if you get a call about contact tracing and you have been identified as a close contact, you really have the power to stop the transmission of this disease and quarantining for those 4 days. And then helping to protect the healthcare system as a whole. I think there's been a lot of great questions about healthcare capacity recently. In Alaska, we run really tight on healthcare capacity at baseline. This time of year is when things tend to be fullest. People are done with hunting and fishing and blueberry gathering. This is the time that people get their knee replacements. This is the time we move indoors. And so we start to share respiratory viruses. People are finishing their deductible and getting other healthcare done. And as a result, the hospitals are always busy this time of year. And you add on top of that a pandemic, things can get very full very quickly. It's been really good to see that our hospitalizations have not been super high for COVID right now, which is great, and hope to keep it that way. But in the meantime, if we're getting our flu shot, wearing our helmet, being safe, making sure we're keeping those beds available, it will make a big difference for the space as a whole. So along those lines, I know people are exhausted. I talk to healthcare workers and providers and teachers and parents around the state all day long. People are tired. People are tired of COVID. I think we all are. But we have amazing ways to be resilient together. It's incredible to watch Alaskans respond to the challenge ahead. Seeing quarantine workers bringing traditional foods to someone in quarantine, having families catch on, calling each other and see how they're doing. Really pulling those bubbles in small so that we can really all stay safe this fall and the winter. So with that, stay safe, be well, be kind. We are in this together and we really are stronger together. Thanks, Alaska.